So today I'll be speaking about like continuous curvature path planning for car-like vehicles and also curvature constraint path planning. So before starting, I would really encourage people to stop me in between whenever they are confused with anything I explain and just ask me the question. And also, like I'll be presenting some equations in a few of my slides and like. Do not worry if you do not understand what the equations say. I'll talk what to focus on in that slide. All right. And understanding that would be good enough. Okay. So let's start. So the flow of the presentation would be I'll be first talking about the parametric continuity of a curve. What do we mean by the curvature continuous paths or similar continuities for curves. Then I'll briefly talk about path planning problems. Then we'll look into like the few frequently used techniques and their issues. So mainly I'll talk about A star RRT algorithm, which are C0 continuous hybrid A star RRT Dugin's path, which are C1 continuous. Then finally we'll look into some continuous curvature path planning techniques. Okay, so like before starting, these are the few equation representations you might know. One is the explicit form y is equal to fx form, like a line equation, implicit form fx y is equal to 0, like a circle, ellipse, or standard equation. And then there are parametric equations which are defined as a x as a function of some t, y as a function of t. So, like we have parametric equations for line and circle. So what is parametric continuity of a curve mean? So continuity is the smoothness of the connection of two curves or surfaces at the connection points or edges. So like suppose you have two independent segments, segment P and segment Q, defined within this interval, parametric segments, all right. So defined within the interval T1, T2, and this also is T1, T2. And you want to connect these two curves. So naturally, like the first condition that you'll think of is the end point of the segment P should match with the first point or the starting point of the segment Q, right? So we'll discuss how are the different techniques to connect these, what are the different techniques to connect this segment. So the three main types of continuity that we'll talk about are C0, C1, and C2. There are many more. We can extend this to CN continuity too, but the three important for us today are C0, 1, and 2. So coming to C0 continuity, a curve is a zero order continuous if both segments intersect at one point. So this is just a basic condition that the coordinates of curve P at the end point should be same as the coordinate of curve Q at its initial point. All right, so this is a zero order continuous curve. Now the C1 continuous curve is said to be first or a curve is said to be first order continuous if it is C0 continuous and the first order derivative of segment at P at T2 is equal to the first order derivative of segment Q at T1. So this basically means is that at the junction both should have the same tangents already in addition to being C0 continuous. So this is C1 continuous. Now for C2 continuity, a curve is said to be second order parametric continuous if it is C0 and C1 continuous, and apart from that it also has its second derivative at this junction equal. All right, so this means we have the acceleration continuity. Why acceleration? Because like the first C0 continuity is just position continuity, the first derivative position is the velocity. So having equal first derivatives means we have equal velocities, and second derivative continuity means we have equal acceleration because derivative of velocity is acceleration. So we'll see why this continuity concept is important in the next upcoming slides. So lastly, I'll talk about this curvature calculation. Suppose we have a curve defined like this, right? So now we have to define a bigger circle that is tangent to this curve, and that is usually called the oscillating circle. I'll show a small video where it might be clear. So you see this circle, this is called the oscillating circle, which is like rotating on this curve. And this red line you see is the radius of the circle, which defines the radius of curvature. Okay. So in this, curvature is actually defined as 1 upon radius, or radius of curvature is defined as 1 upon curvature of this. So why curvature is important to us? Because like suppose we have a curve defined as y is equal to f of x and the position vector as x I cap plus j cap. The curvature formula turns out to be this. And similarly for a parametric equation, it turns out to be this. Now the important thing to notice here is that we have second derivative terms here, right? So this means that to have a continuous curvature, we need to have continuous second derivatives of our function. That is, now we need to have C2 continuous curves to have constant curvature, or continuous curvature, not a constant, but a continuous curvature. So that means a continuous curvature says that our can actually say that our curve is at least C2 continuous. So that is why we actually see the continuity of curvature while defining our while saying that how continuous our final curve is. So now diving into a common path planning for robots. The main goal of this path planning is to find a feasible path connecting the start and end goal for the robot. Okay, the environment might contain obstacles, and you can see in this figure, this is a robot that starts at this point, and there are two paths defined for it, connecting from start to your end goal. So the green path is like C0 continuous, as we had seen before, and the red one is a quite smoother path. Okay, so like this, for car to follow the green path, it will have to stop at each end point and has to take a zero radius turn, right, which is not actually feasible for car like robots. While following the red, it will deviate, like it will have minimum deviations from this original path. So this is something that is desired, and we'll look how to get these curves. Okay, so we'll start with a very primitive path planning technique. So planning, we'll start with discrete graph-based planning. So planning is performed in discrete space since it simplifies the problem. So instead of planning in continuous space, which has like infinite possibilities for a robot to be in, so we actually divide this our world into small grid world. So what it does is like each grid represents a state in which the robot can be. So basically it divides the world into small grids, and that grid is the only place where the robot can be, and not like in the junction or any middle point. All right, so at each state the robot has a maximum of 8 positions to basically move to. So being over here, it has like 8 positions. Being here, it has 3 positions, and similarly, like you can see, it has a maximum of 8 adjacent positions to move to. So this greatly simplifies our planning problem, and based on this concept we have a technique called ASR planning. So the search is directed towards the goal, and it uses a cost function with a heuristic function h of n to direct its search. So what the cost function is, suppose we have this kind of a grid space and we currently are at x1. So the cost to move from x1 to x2, like from year to year, will be 1. And cost to move from x1 to x9 will be 1.4, that is like root 2. So 1, 1 and this root 2. Now to the cost to move from x1 to x8 will be 1000 if x8 is an obstacle. So here like the obstacles are represented by gray boundaries. So starting from, suppose, like the green position to move on the right, this is an infeasible move, right? Because you'll like collide with the obstacle. So it has a higher cost. And similarly, moving from x1 to x9, given that x9 is an obstacle, is 10,000.4. Okay. So heuristic function is defined as the direct Euclidean distance from our current position to the final goal. The actual distance might be different, so this actual distance might be the actual path which the vehicle takes, but since we are trying to find this path, determining the cost, we take the heuristic function as direct distance from the goal to our current goal. So our final cost function consists of two terms, which is the cost to come from a start node to our current position, and the heuristic function which you define, which is from that node to directly the goal position. Okay, so you can see one sample scenario and the search happening. And this is the final path that we obtain. Now the problem with ASR approach is that the vehicle might need to slow down at every waypoint, which is undesirable for the car like vehicle. So like you can see, it has very sharp turns. So these are actually zero radius turns, and the vehicle would have to stop and then turn, and even then it would actually deviate. Actual car would deviate from this path. So that is why it is not desirable for car-like vehicles. It is memory inefficient, and it has exponential growth of search space with increase in length of solution. So what this means is, suppose we start at green position, right? Now we are basically exploring the world. You see, like our algorithm is exploring the world till it reaches the final goal. So we start at the green position. We explore its surrounding adjacent nodes. We save them and we save their cost, and then we choose one which has the minimum cost according to this. We move, suppose like it would, for the first step it would be this block here. Now after we come here, we again try to find the adjacent nodes. We save that in a history or a queue, and then we try to find the node with the minimum cost. So this is done at every node, and then we find the path. So as our grid space like increases, or the solution length increases, we have to explore more number of nodes, and we have to save more nodes in our memory. This is also impractical for real-time planning, which might require constant replanning. So for constantly replanning, this would not do a very good job. There are variants of this algorithm which I'll not discuss over here, which solves some of these issues, but this having C0 continuity in its path, so having this kind of sharp edges, is still a big problem. Another similar technique is what we call randomly exploring random trees, or RRT. So this is a probabilistic path planning algorithm. It randomly samples the state space. So this is kind of a continuous space path planning approach, in which we try to build a tree in our continuous space and try to find a solution, basically connecting a start and end goal. So suppose we have a tree, we randomly sample a point. So you can see Q random is the new our state. And after sampling this, we try to find the nearest node in our tree. So suppose like this was our nearest node, and then on this straight line connecting our Q random and Q nearest node, we define a new node with our predefined step size. So this is how we constantly expand our tree until the time we find a direct path connecting the node and the goal position. So like this is how it expands. Now, issues with RRTR, it again does not generate smooth paths that can be easily tracked by the vehicle. This is again like C1 continuous path. And also it has one more issue that it cannot say if no path exists. So it will keep on building trees in the whole continuous space until it reaches either max number of iterations, or the only limiting factor is the max number of iterations that you might define. Or it finds, obviously, the feasible path. So we'll stop when the max number of iterations is reached. And it also has asymptotic convergence. Its convergence time depends on sampling. So every time you run the ASR algorithm, you will get the same solution. But for this RRT, every time you run, you might get a different solution, because it is probabilistic based. It is sampling the points in this continuous search space. That's why like this random point will define how the tree grows and what path you find. So for this reason, each time might get a different curve. or path. Now we have talked about C0 continuity, which are not feasible. So before moving on, let's see what is the kinematic model for a given vehicle. Okay, so what paths actually it can follow based on its kinematics. So suppose this is a car, the XY or the reference point in the car is between the rear axle, and the forward wheels actually define its position, okay, and it actually steers the vehicle. So this delta angle which is defined is the steering angle. So from its body axis, how much are the wheels turned? So this angle defines that. V is the velocity of the vehicle, L is the length of the vehicle. So based on that, we actually define our velocities and the angular rate of the vehicle. So suppose, like, imagine a practical scenario. Okay, you're driving with a constant speed and you steer, you have a constant steering angle. So you rotate your wheel to a constant value. So your car will actually be going in a circle, right? So that is the circle that it follows will have a radius. So that will define your radius of turning, or the radius of curvature for that path. And if you turn the wheel, steering wheel to a maximum to either right or left, you'll be actually getting a minimum turning radius for that, or a maximum curvature path for that vehicle. So that is actually what constrains your vehicle. So it does not have, a real car does not have zero turning radius. Instead, it is limited by this. Okay, so based on this, we assume some value for V, the speed. It might not be 1 meter per second. You can take any value. And then we sample discrete values for steering angle. Okay, so it is sampled between minus delta max and delta max. So delta max is your maximum steering angle that you can have. That might be different for different vehicles. So thus, by plugging in values and by integrating these velocities and omega, so we'll get these kinds of curves. So these will have constant radius of curvature. For each will have a different one, but will have a constant radius of curvature. This is because, like, you are selecting values for V, L and delta, and you are sampling these paths. So you are basically fixing your omega for the vehicle, and you have fixed your V. So by V is equal to omega R, you'll get a constant R, right? So that is the path that you get over here. So we can actually use this for planning better paths. So one of the methods is like using Dubin's curve. So in this, you consider the maximum steering angle resulting in minimum radius turn. Okay, so for each move, you are either keeping your steering angle to zero or at delta max. So you'll be always following minimum radius curves over here. So with this, like, you can see there are actually a few possibilities. So there are six possibilities of getting these motion primitives. And also, like, this model assumes that vehicle can only move in forward, not in reverse. And it also gives the shortest path connecting two waypoints. It requires the initial and final heading. So here you can see the vehicle starts from this point and it has to reach this point. So we have also mentioned the initial headings and final headings that is desired for the vehicle. So based on this, we get a few paths. So for this case, we get left, straight, and again left, or right, straight, and again right. We can also get a left, straight, and a right path, or a right, straight, left path. And for these configurations, like, you can get left, right, and left. So, and again, right, left, right. So these are the six motion primitives that, these are the minimum motion primitives required to reach any configuration space. So using these Dubin's curve, we actually, in this paper, they actually merged this Dubin's curve with RRT. So previously in RRT, what we were doing were, we had our motion primitives of straight line, right? So we actually replaced this with these Dubin's curves, and we try to build the tree. So our state space now becomes positions as well as the theta which it it has taken to follow that small segment. Now the random tree is built and the connect and the sampled points are now connected using the Dubin's curve. And the RRT helps in obstacle avoidance for reaching the goal, and the Dubin's curve provide C1 continuous path. So this is a sample scenario. The image isn't very clear, but I'll show you some simulations for this. So these paths can be actually improved by path pruning methods. So what path pruning methods do is, like they find a better path through this already obtained path. So with RRT and this method, we get a feasible path, but it might not be optimal. So once we get any feasible path, we can actually improve this path by some pruning methods that, like I won't cover these now, you can search for these methods. Wait, I'll show you a simulation for this also, RRT Dubin's. Yes, you can see this working. Yeah, so you can see this generating a tree, sampling a random point, and then finally it will find a solution. Yeah, so finally it found this red solution to this. So this is one of the ways to get C1 continuous paths. So why this is C1 is because like we are getting these arcs, right? And then from here we go straight and maybe take another turn. So for this segment, we are actually following some R1 radius curve. Then at this junction, this has infinite radius and zero curvature. So at this point, you're actually transiting directly from some constant curvature K1 to zero curvature. So this actually has a discontinuity. If you plot the curvature for this, so like either time or any parameter and versus curvature. So for this segment, you will have some constant curvature, then you instantly dip to zero curvature, and then you instantly follow some other curvature over here. So for this, we don't have a constant acceleration, right, which is desired for vehicle. So in this, if a car tries to follow this path, it will have some deviations around this region and again around this region. Any doubts or any questions till this point? Okay, I'll continue.
Hello.
Yeah.
What? Yeah. In this RRT, where you're including the Dubin's curves, what exactly are we sampling?
What exactly are we sampling? So we are again taking some random point, and then suppose we have this node, right? So we try to reach with a delta over here. Like we are sampling x, y, and theta. Okay.
Okay.
So we try to fit a Dubin's curve to reach that angle and that xy position with that delta.
So when we expand a tree in normal RRT,
yes,
we basically take a point in the direction of the sampled point. So over here, when we expand the tree, what exactly are we, what would be our new node?
Our new node would again be, I mean, suppose you have this kind of tree, right? Now you sample another node here. You will decide a step size of some delta, and you have x, y, and like there are many different ways. So you can also take the theta over here to be this. And then you have some theta over here, you have some theta over here. So you can try to find a Dubin's curve for this, right?
Okay.
So like in this, if you see, so you are expanding this. So like in this, actually what they have done is they do not take the sampling, like they do not try to take this intermediate point, they directly consider this one, and they have the xy theta and xy theta, so they would actually directly connect this. So in their algorithm,
okay.
they directly took that.
Got it.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
So in case of RRT, like the normal one, what is the point of the step size? Like you mentioned right now that they don't take the step size, they directly connect it. So
yeah. So now when you consider this Dubin's curves, right? So like suppose you have a tree like this, you have a Dubin's tree like this. Now you randomly sample one point here, you have a theta here. So if you take an intermediate point in this case, so like this doesn't always seem to be a good option, right? You, if you sample it at a very small distance, it might be infeasible to connect a path, or it would be something like very complicated path. So in a small region around here, you can actually sample a point very far away, and you can a little far, like not very far away, and you can actually reach there if there exists a feasible path. So in this algorithm, if you see, here we take a random node, we take a near node, and we take a new node. Okay, so in the simulation that I showed, they didn't have a near node, they were directly connecting that, and this is from a different paper, so they actually consider a near node. And you take a new node along that, then you try to generate a Dubin's curve between that new node and your nearest node. Okay, then if there exists a Dubin's curve that like if there exists a feasible curve or it doesn't intersect any obstacle, then you add that new node to your already existing list. Otherwise you try to find another random sample and then do it. So again, as I said, like there are various ways to do this. You might take a nearest node, you might not take, you might take directly the random sampled point, and you can find that.
Okay. And in case of the normal like RRT, standard
yeah.
RRT, why is the step size used? Like why it is like it connects it either to the point directly or the step size, whichever is minimum in that in the direction of the new sampled node, right?
So suppose like I randomly would have sampled a point here. Okay, now a straight line connecting this would actually pass through obstacle. Like suppose I had a nearest node here and a straight line connecting this would actually pass through the obstacle, but if I take a small step size, right, it won't like hit this obstacle. So that would give me a feasible tree to expand to, or a feasible node to expand to, right?
Yeah.
If we directly connect this point, there will be many points that you might have to exclude based on your obstacles and all.
Oh yeah.
So that's
why in terms of sampling, so some samplings might be wasted, you're saying, in case.
Yes. In case you're directly taking the whole length, you will waste a lot more samples than what you might do when you take a small step size.
Okay.
That is another reason. Any more questions regarding this? Okay, so another the last method for C1 candidate that I'll discuss is hybrid ASR. So in the previous Dubin's method, we were only considering a max curvature or minimum radius terms, right? What if we actually take some more intermediate values? We might get better results. So that is what happens in this hybrid ASR, and the planning happens in continuous state space by using set of pre-computed motion primitives, and it satisfies minimum turning radius constraint of the vehicle. So here you can see, this is a picture from I think MathWorks tutorial. So at the starting point, it took some 5 samples, and at every point it took 5 samples and expanded like A star while it got to its final goal. So again, this would have the same issue of discontinuous curvature. So yeah, the above discussed method gives paths that are continuous in the first derivative, that is the C1 continuity. These paths have second derivative discontinuity due to the assumption that vehicle can instantaneously change the steering angle. Now we have sampled the steering angles, right? So that is equivalent to assuming we can instantaneously change the steering angle, and this leads to deviations from the path. So this assumption is not practically valid. So I even have a simulation to show for this MBD star. So this is a path for the vehicle, and like this is the curvature profile for this path. So this is the path obtained from hybrid ASR. You can see like there are jump discontinuities over here. So this is again not C2 continuous. So our main motivation for having C2 continuous is when we are driving a vehicle, right? To move forward, we actually press the gas pedal. That basically applies a force on the vehicle, right? The engine applies a force on the vehicle, which basically is like changing the acceleration of the vehicle. So that is why when our input is acceleration, the path that we want to follow should have continuity in an acceleration so that we can smoothly change our acceleration. So that is the main reason why we are looking for this second derivative continuity or the curvature continuity. So some of the methods that give this second order continuity are like using the Clothoid's curve. So like the first method that we can think of is let's just define this curvature kappa as a linear function. Okay, alpha is the sharpness and s is the parameter. Like we have x is equal to f of t, so here we have taken the parameter as s, and k0 is our initial curvature of the path. Now theta of s is our actual heading, or the theta that we have for our vehicle. So that is actually obtained by integrating that kappa of u. X of s similarly are obtained by integrating cos of theta and sine of theta. So the main thing to notice here is that we have this curvature as a linear function of our parameter. So if you just integrate this for s equal to some values, so you'll get from zero curvature, you'll get increasing curvature, and the radius of curvature basically keeps on shrinking. Now using this clothoid, we actually try to smoothen our paths. In this, we have combined, this author has combined Dugin's curves or the circular arcs with these clothoids. So the main motivation is that we divide the segment into three parts. The middle one is a circular arc, and these two are the transition curve. So what we do is, suppose we have a corner, okay? Now we want to smoothly transition from this edge to this edge. So the first thing that we can do is we can just try to fit a minimum radius curve over here, minimum radius circle over here, and we just transition directly from this to this. But this again has a problem of C1 continuity because we have curvature k is equal to 0 here, and then we suddenly jump to k is equal to some constant C, and then again k is equal to 0. So what they do is they basically take these two segments, they define their circle, but they have some space in the middle, and to join smoothly to this circle, they define clothoids. So basically what we saw was clothoids allow us to smoothly transition between k is equal to from kappa 0 to kappa 1 and from kappa 1 to kappa 0 here. So for that, we define two points over here. We know the curvature because we know the minimum turning radius, Rmin, of our vehicle. And we select these transition curves. We smoothly connect this over here and here. So So with this, we get a smooth transition in our final path, smooth curvature profile for our final path. So yeah, so this looks something like this. So in this, like the circular segment is zero and both connect at the midpoint. And here we take a segment. So this would actually define how our path looks. So for more like information on this, you can refer to this paper here. So any doubts in this? Okay. So next, one of the methods is like defining four parameter logistic curves. So like suppose you have a scenario like this and we want to move, we are given some initial waypoints here like W1, W2, W3. We could get actually these waypoints by any of the previously defined methods. So maybe like, you know, RRT Dubin's RRT method by A star method or hybrid A star method. So now these waypoints are defined. We want to fit smooth continuous paths from through connecting these waypoints. We call this as interpolation. So the 4PL curves actually are defined by this formula, and the property of the 4PL is that they by nature have continuous curvature. Okay, so these are written in global frame and this is written in local frame. It is named as 4PL or 4 parameters because the main 4 parameters that define these curves are the yi plus 1, the b and the c. So by changing all of these parameters, we can actually change the shape of how this curve looks. Okay. Actually, from this equation, we already know the values of yi and yi plus 1 because we have already defined our waypoint. So the only two parameters that we need to tune are B and C to get smooth curves. So these curves are basically like segregated into two main types of curves. One is called the S-shaped paths and one is called the half S-shaped path. So half S-shaped paths are basically like exactly half of this. And one of the main important properties that these curves have is they have zero starting and ending curvature. Even for half a shape path, so the starting curvature at this starting point is zero, and also here it would be zero. So having this property is important because suppose like we have two segments. Okay, now we have some curvature 1 year, curvature 2 year, curvature 3 year, curvature 4 year. We are talking about this endpoint because we need this to stitch. Now we want to stitch curves at these two points, okay, W1 and W2. Now, since they have different curvatures, it would be very difficult to stitch, actually impossible to fit with continuous curvature. So that is why if we have both as zero, okay, now we just need to maintain C0 and C1 continuity over here. So if we just ensure that the tangents match, this property of having zero curvature at the ends would automatically like give us C2 continuity. Okay, so this is the main advantage that we get using these curves. Now, yeah, so we actually transform this 4PL curves to the local coordinate frame, which gives us this equation. And we are considering half S shape paths here. Another property of this 4PL curves is that it has a confinement region, a triangular confinement region. So suppose we have one waypoint and another waypoint. Okay. Now we define a heading over here, H1, and we define a desired heading over here, H2. So we can, the 4PLs always are guaranteed to stay inside this region. So this actually simplifies our obstacle avoidance problem. So we can say that if these three edges do not intersect any obstacle in our given environment, our 4PL will never intersect any obstacle or collide with any obstacle. So this actually simplifies our problem for obstacle checking. And obstacle checking is actually one of the most computationally intensive tasks when we come to path planning. It's usually the most intensive task. So with this, we actually, the most important thing in this slide is the formulas for, or the analytical expressions for this B and C design parameter. So you can see, these are defined based on XW, YW and theta W. So we already know XW, YW because we know what is our next waypoint or the goal waypoint we want to go to. The only freedom we have is in theta W. So actually by just selecting our desired theta W at this point, we can fix our B parameter, and using this B parameters, we can actually fix our C parameters. So if our only design parameter now remains is the theta W, which is the relative angle between our start and endpoint. So that is why we are actually taking it in the local frame. We actually use, like if you see in this figure, here we define this in our local coordinate frame, okay? So we make this this W4 at 0, 0 with zero heading, and we try to find the heading for W5. So this can be taken as W4 and this can be taken as W5. So if we just select theta W, so this is the like the relative heading angle, we get the parameters of B and C. So now our problem for fitting this four-pill curves boil down to just selecting this heading angles at each waypoint. So in this case, we actually can formulate as an optimization problem where we minimize the total path length. So the final path that we get has some path length, right? So we can just minimize that, and for given values of theta. So we are minimizing our path length to find our theta i's at all the waypoints, and subject to these constraints. So this is just like a heading constraint that we have. So here if we see, for four PLs, we can actually derive this constraint that theta can should always be greater than this and less than this, or should lie within this range. And yeah, so that is that one constraint. And we can also add another constraint that our curvature for that segment should be always less than our K-max, which will depend on the vehicle that we use. Now the third constraint is that no segment or no curve should intersect with the obstacle. So basically intersection of the confinement region and the obstacle should be null. So we can actually formulate this as an optimization problem and get the values of theta i's. So you can see like an example scenario in which we get this values. Now another like the final method that I want to discuss is bidirectional RRT with B-spline parameterization. So if you look at this paper, they argue that we normally follow this procedure, that is we do a random search, and while the goal is not reached, we kind of keep on doing that search while we get these intermediate waypoints. So this random search process is can be like a A-star or RRT algorithm, wherein we get those intermediate waypoints. So even here, like we get W0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, connecting a start and end goal. And then we try to do a spline parameterization. So basically, like in this, we are, after obtaining the waypoints, we try to fit our curve. But we don't take into consideration that the path might not be feasible, like fitting the splines through like these previously obtained waypoints might not be feasible with such constraints. So the final path might not obey the curvature max bound, or might not be feasible because while determining these waypoints, we haven't actually considered this. So our initial waypoints could have had a very sharp turn through which it would be infeasible to fit a K-max curvature constrained path. So for that, they actually remove this decoupling between our first random search and spline parameterization. So we do a random search including this spline parameterization. this is something very similar to the Dubins with RRT, but instead we use something called as B-splines, which are again similar types of curves which give us a C2 continuity. Okay, and bidirectional RRT is simply so we actually had read about the RRT, right? So suppose we have a start goal, we have an end goal, we keep on expanding our tree from this point, right? But in bidirectional, we actually expand a tree from both the start and end. And if we come very close to this tree, so we directly connect them. Okay, so we get a path here, and we can actually prune this path and get a shorter path. Suppose we had obstacles here, so we would actually prune this path and get a shorter path. So like, just this is the bidirectional RRT. We expand our tree from both the start and end point. So like, they use bidirectional RRT with these B-spline parameterization. So this is their conceptual diagram for B-spline. So here you can see in the RRT we had straight lines, right? And in this we have B-splines, and also these B-splines have zero end curvatures, because you know, again, we want to stitch again and again to B-splines, right? And it would be very simple if we have zero end curvatures. So in this reference paper, they use B-spline as motion primitives with bidirectional RRT. This ensures C2 smooth joining of the curves, because the B-splines are actually C2 curves, specifically the cubic B-splines. The cubic B-splines provide curvature continuity, and we can also have them satisfy zero end curvature thing. So there's a zero start and end curvature that facilitates this joining of segments, and they also retain max curvature bound. So I actually won't go into detail how they retain this, but we can actually find analytical expressions to find the curvature for every segment. So you can look at this paper to see how they do it. So again, in RRT, like how we used to expand our node with straight lines, here we expand with a B-spline. And apart from that, we also have our max alpha and d max constraint. So this is like, in one segment we define how much maximum distance that vehicle can travel, and also what is the maximum steering angle for that with that d max. So using this, we define our new curve. So here are some of the simulation scenarios. Like, these are typical test cases that one might want to try with while testing their path planning algorithm. So this is a very narrow passage. This one is a trap. So trap is like, this is a non-convex thing. And if we try to just use a simple ASR here, it would try to search every single node over here and then actually go out. But with RRT, the advantage is that since it samples a point randomly, so you might have the probability of finding this pass early. So like, they have tested for different kinds of scenarios. Now the black path which you see is a pruned path, and the red path is the original path that we get. So with the RRT, this red path would have been very crooked straight line C0 path, and this is a better smooth pruned path. Now this is like for different cluttered scenarios, and you can see the curvature profiles for all. So this is a field scenario, and this is a cluttered scenario. So for the trap, for the cluttered, for narrow, and for the field, you can see we have smooth curvature profiles for each path. So this was actually it from my side. Now, if you have like any questions regarding any of these methods, free to ask them.
Yes, one more question from my side.
Yeah.
So the RRT with B-spline method with the pruning,
yes.
When you prune a path in this method, it is already a path with either C1 or C2 continuity, right?
Right.
So in normal LOS optimization pruning, we are removing points directly, right?
Right.
Over here, how are you deciding between which two points you want to connect the new spline?
Yeah, good question. So here when we are joining our B splines, right? So here our sample space is XY plus a theta. Okay. So when we try to connect to any of this intermediate nodes directly from our start or any intermediate point, we actually are trying to fit XY and that theta variable, right? We have that theta variable. So we can actually see what is our max curvature if we directly join those two paths. So if you are able to do so without hitting any obstacle, like we can directly join, right? So suppose from the start and end point here, so it is searching for all the intermediate waypoint, and it found that over here, the theta and XY points satisfy my thing, my curvature constraint also, if I directly join my start and this intermediate point. So why not I directly go from here to here?
Okay, so basically the two endpoints would still be among the original waypoints. You won't have an endpoint in the intermediate spline from the original path.
I mean, you can do that by like checking every small second, because you know, like theta, you know the theta variations, right? When those theta variations are actually continuous because your paths are even continuous, but that would actually be computationally expensive.
Yeah.
So you can do that. You can also check with intermediate waypoints. So it depends on your algorithm.
Hmm. Okay.
Anyways, so thanks for the talk, Meg.
Yeah, no problem.
Yeah. So here, like, three alag methods, right? So one is the Clotard one is the B-spline one, and another is the 4PL one.
Right.
So, has there any comparison done between those three?
Between these three, no. Yeah, there is no paper like comparing, or there are no results comparing directly these three results. But there would be comparing, like, so like one of the 4PL methods that I showed, that is like a section of my own work. So mera first paper tha usi hamara usi pe tha.
So wait, you tested out the algorithm 4PL, or you worked on making that 4PL algorithm?
The 4PL was already there, like one of the people, the person working at ISC had previously used this algorithm jo 4PL ka tha. But like he made many assumptions that we know the waypoints, we know the heading angles and so on. So he was manually choosing the B and C parameters. So we, like, this is just one of the small segments of our paper. We formulate an optimization problem to solve that. So we actually converted that to an optimization to, and like with the curvature constraint.
Okay, so. Yes.
By the way, I was just thinking, maybe we should move to another one because this has been recorded.
I mean, doubts here. It's fine. Right?
I mean, yeah, then we can ask it. Or first and doubts.
Yeah. So, these three methods. So for you said like for UAV you were planning, right? So did you try out other methods or you just chose 4PL because it was being previously worked upon?
Yeah, so initially like we wanted something to start with, right? So iske liye the fastest method was like 4PL because someone had already worked on it.
Yeah.
But right now we are actually moving to like different methods because 4PL has some theta constraints that I had showed you. So there are some constraints on the relative heading angle that 4PLs can obey. And for higher relative angles, it actually gives out a very high curvature value. So those are some of the advantages of using 4PL. So that's why we might be using the clothoid or the B-spline base. So we are actually not the clothoid one. I actually recently found, so that's why I mentioned that here. So I'm exploring that part, and also with B-spline, I have some different results that we are currently. So basically, like these clothoids and B-spline give you a lot of flexibility. But with a lot of flexibility, you get a lot of parameters to tune. Okay, you get a lot of things that you want to select. So with a lot of flexibility, that choosing becomes very difficult. So you need to find a very good, simple solution to your problem.
Right. Like in 4PL, we only had one parameter to tune.
Yes, exactly.
Okay. That's good. Thank you for the talk.
Yeah, great talk, man.
Yeah,
see you.
All right. Thank you for attending.